I hope you've enjoyed the first season of the American Gods series as much as I have. Bryan Fuller and Michael Green have done an excellent job adapting, expounding upon, and updating Neil Gaiman's source material. The series seems to be staying true to the spirit of the novel, while keeping fans of it guessing which direction it will go next. That's not an easy tightrope to walk, but they seem to be walking it so far. In this video, I will first cover the gods and other mythical beings in the first season of American Gods that I didn't cover in my last video. If you haven't seen my first video about the mythology behind American Gods, please click on the link below and come back to this video afterwards. Once I've finished covering the remaining gods of season 1, I will then cover the remaining gods and mythical beings in the novel that will likely show up in the second or perhaps the third season of the series, unless they get cut. To avoid any serious spoilers, I will not reveal exactly how these characters fit into the story, and simply let you in on the mythology and history that inspired them, with a little context from the novel here and there. The novel rarely reveals in explicit detail who exactly the gods in the story are, or what their history is, leading many readers to bookmark and check Wikipedia as they read it. The series seems to be equally unapologetic in its esoteric use of mythology. So this video is meant to give you some backstory and context for the characters while you watch the series. But if you don't want to know which gods will show up in the remaining seasons of this series, please click away from this video now. Well, subscribe and then click away. Before we get started, I want to quickly acknowledge a few mistakes I made in my previous video about American Gods. Number 1, I referred to Odin's ravens, Hugin and Munin, as thought and mind. In some translations, Munin is mind, but a more accurate translation is memory. While I'm on the subject, this is a good time to mention that Odin also has two wolves, Geri and Freki. Mistake number 2, I said Thoth weighs the heart of the newly dead in Egyptian mythology. In fact, Anubis weighs the heart, while Thoth records the result. Now that we have that out of the way, let's get started.
This country went to hell when they stopped hanging folks.
One of the characters introduced in the first episode of American Gods is a member of Wednesday's own pantheon. Loki Leismith, Shadow's prison cellmate, is the most obvious alias ever for Loki, the god of mischief and deceit in Norse mythology. Loki is a member of the Æsir tribe, the top tier of gods in the Norse pantheon. He is the son of Forbauti, the Jotun or giant, and Lauvoi, the Æsir goddess. Unlike in the Marvel universe, Loki is not the son of Odin, through adoption or otherwise, but he and Odin are blood brothers. In fact, both he and Odin swore an oath that one would never be served a drink if the other was not also. Sounds like a pretty good deal for Loki. Odin likely regretted that whole blood brother pact in hindsight, as Loki is responsible for many betrayals toward him and the Æsir, including the semi-accidental death of Odin's son Balder and his alliance with the Jotnar during Ragnarok. Loki also happens to be the proud father of the goddess of Hel, Hel, the world serpent Jormungandr, who is fated to kill Thor, and the giant wolf Fenrir, who is fated to kill Odin.
Do not piss off those bitches in airports.
Next, we have a being from Arabic mythology that has fallen on hard times in America and forced to drive a cab in order to make ends meet. The jinn are thought to be one of three sapient beings in creation, along with humans and angels, and they were created from a scorching, smokeless fire. However, you might be more familiar with the anglicized version of their name, genie.
We ain't men.
Unlike the Christian concept of demons, the jinn are neutral beings with free will, much like humans. They can be benevolent or evil, I guess depending on their mood. The jinn in American Gods belongs to the Ifrit, one of 5 classifications of jinn. The Ifrit are thought to be the most dangerous of the jinn, often appearing as flaming, winged creatures who sometimes perform acts of vengeance. The mythology doesn't mention anything about the Ifrit having one-night stands with people and then stealing that person's clothes while they sleep, but that might be a particularly convoluted form of revenge.
I do not grant wishes.
In the American Gods series, Wednesday and Shadow meet an old Roman god who doesn't appear in the novel. Vulcan is the Roman god of fire, volcanoes, and metalwork. His equivalent in the Greek pantheon is Hephaestus, who forged weapons for the gods of Olympus. In Greek mythology, Hephaestus is the son of the thunder god, Zeus, and Hera, the goddess of marriage and family. In some versions of the mythology, Hera births Hephaestus asexually, but immediately regrets her decision when she notices how ugly the child is, and decides to throw him from Mount Olympus, Spartan style. However, Hephaestus survives, perfects his smithing craft under the ocean, and eventually gets revenge on Hera by trapping her on an enchanted throne. Happy Mother's Day. In some versions of the story, Hephaestus's legs are broken and deformed by the fall from Mount Olympus. And in others, Hera rejects him because he has a deformed leg from birth. Either way, this explains why Vulcan has a limp in American Gods. While Hephaestus was worshipped for both the constructive and destructive properties of fire, Vulcan's worship focused more on the destructive side. The Roman festival of Vulcanalia was held in late August, when crops were most vulnerable to fires, and offerings to Vulcan were meant to avert fire-related disasters. In American Gods, Vulcan buys into the modern arms industry, inspiring an entirely new kind of worship and sacrifice from Americans.
Every bullet fired in a crowded movie theater is a prayer, in my name.
The strange tree creature that Shadow encounters in the fifth episode of American Gods is an agent for Mr. World called Mr. Wood. In the novel, Mr. Wood and his fellow agents, Mr. Stone and Mr. Town, are minor characters, and there is no indication that they are gods. However, in the series, Wednesday alludes to the fact that Mr. Wood is a very old deity, perhaps even one of the first, who has rebranded and joined the new gods.
Mr. Wood was the trees, Mr. Wood was the forest. Well, he was a very old god who saw something very new. He saw a god-driven society.
This suggests that Mr. Wood was once an animistic deity, as animism is one of the oldest known forms of religious belief, predating even paganism. In animism, all things, including animals, plants, and inanimate objects, can potentially have a soul or spiritual essence. Early humans likely worshipped trees and forests in this way, giving rise to Mr. Wood.
I respect wood. I revere wood. I'm considerate of wood.
The same theory can be applied to Mr. Wood's partner in the novel, Mr. Stone. I'm not sure how Mr. Town would fit into this theory, but he and Mr. Stone have yet to be introduced in the series, so we'll have to wait and see.
And then I get stabbed by Charlie Brown's Christmas tree!
Shadow's dreams are full of strange, mythical creatures. The first to appear is the buffalo with flaming eyes, who is a buffalo-headed man in the novel. Buffalo play an important role in Native American mythology, especially in the Great Plains, where they were once a major source of food. The buffalo were seen as sacred creatures, and plains tribes like the Sioux and Cheyenne would often perform rituals before hunting them, like ceremonial dances and prayers. However, the buffalo in American Gods plays a somewhat different role, which I won't spoil for you.
Believe.
Now that we've covered all the gods and mythical beings who make an appearance in the first season of American Gods, let's get into the remaining gods in the novel, who will likely show up in the second or third season of the series. The first in this category is a headstrong Indian woman called Mama G. Mama G is in fact the Hindu goddess of destruction, time, and change, Kali, or
Kalima.
This goddess is one of the 10 Mahavidyas, 10 different aspects of one supreme goddess, called Adi Parashakti. Although, according to a Tamil movie I once saw, it's pronounced Adi Parashakti. Kali is often depicted with black or blue skin, 4 to 10 arms which hold weapons and a severed head, wearing a necklace of human skulls, and displaying an outstretched, bloody tongue. On top of that, she is typically standing or dancing on her husband and partner in destruction, Shiva. Not exactly the most inviting image, but in spite of her appearance, Kali is a source of creative as well as destructive power. Many Hindu sects see Kali as the divine mother, a protector, liberator, and a destroyer of the human ego rather than a goddess of death. But make no mistake, Kali is also a mighty warrior, known for slaying powerful demons like Raktabija and drinking their blood. Definitely the kind of goddess Wednesday would like to recruit for his war. Another of Wednesday's potential recruits is a creature from Wednesday's native pantheon whose name is sometimes mistaken for Elvis. However, in American Gods, Alvis is king of the dwarves, rather than rock and roll. In Norse mythology, dwarves are short, robust creatures who dwell in the caves and tunnels of Svartalfheim. The gods created them from maggots within the body of the giant Ymir, and despite their humble origins, dwarves developed into the most skilled smiths and metalworkers in Norse mythology. They forged the Æsir's most powerful weapons, like Mjolnir, Thor's hammer, and Gungnir, Odin's spear. In the poem Alvismol, Alvis the dwarf approaches Thor to ask for his daughter's hand in marriage. Rather than simply telling Alvis to bugger off, Thor opts to avoid an awkward situation by making Alvis answer questions until dawn, at which point the dwarf turns into stone. In mythology, Hreidmar is king of the dwarves until he's murdered by his son. But in American Gods, the crown belongs to Alvis. The novel also describes Alvis as being an impressive 5 foot 9 inches tall, making him a giant among his people and an entirely average height among men.
Well, this is a thing unheard of!
Staying within the Norse pantheon for the next one, Gaiman sure loves him some Norse pantheon. We have three weird sisters who aid Shadow in his quest. They are Urd, Vertandi, and Skuld, the three Norns, or Fates, from Norse mythology. The three sisters are of the Jotun, or giant race, and watch over the Well of Fate, Urdrabrunner, one of three enchanted wells that reside at the base of the world tree, Yggdrasil. There, they watch over and control the destiny of all mankind. Their counterparts in Greek mythology are the Moirai, who also control man's fate by weaving the thread of life. Unlike their Greek counterparts, the Norns carve man's fate rather than weave it, and there are not only three of them, but potentially many throughout the Nine Realms. So why are they so weird? Well, the name of one of the Norns, Urd, is the root of the word weird in English. Plus, they're just weird.
I know you know.
The next character is not simply an American god, but a Native American god. Well, technically he's a culture hero, but still. The middle-aged Native American man that Shadow and Wednesday meet in the Badlands of North Dakota goes by the name Whiskey Jack, which is an anglicized version of his true name, Wisakijak, although it's pronounced differently depending on the source. Wisakijak is a trickster figure known to the Algonquin, Cree, and Dene nations, among others. Wisakijak was given power by the Creator, or Great Spirit, including the ability to shapeshift and speak with animals. He is often said to be responsible for a great flood, similar to the flood myth of other cultures, which he survived due to his trickery. Aside from his mischievous deeds, Wisakijak is also credited with many benevolent acts. For instance, helping to rebuild the world after the aforementioned flood, and giving the laws of nature to the Cree people. In the American Gods novel, Wednesday and Shadow find Whiskey Jack on a Lakota reservation. Wednesday points out that Whiskey Jack is not Lakota, but it is later revealed that the people there believe him to be Iktomi, the trickster spider spirit from Lakota myth. Yes, yet another trickster spider spirit. This makes sense considering some Iktomi stories are attributed to Wisaki Jack, or vice versa. In the novel, Whiskey Jack's nephew is called Harry Bluejay, and is likely a Bluejay spirit from Native American myth. Like Wisaki Jack, the Bluejay is seen as a trickster, but is often a far more greedy and careless one, especially on the northwest coast. In Cree myth, Wisaki Jack sometimes appears as a gray jay, which explains in an odd way why he and Harry Bluejay are related.
And you thought he was some crazy old coot talking myths and bullshit.
Another mythical creature that starts popping up in Shadow's dreams and plays an important part later on is the Thunderbird, a legendary creature also found in Native American mythology. There are many variations on the Thunderbird in mythology, depending on the source. But generally, they are giant eagle-like birds who create thunder by flapping their wings. They control the upper world and fight against giant serpents and evil spirits from the underworld. In the Menominee tradition, they come from a great mountain in the sky. And according to the Winnebago, a man who has a vision of a Thunderbird during a solitary fast will become a war chief.
Thunderbirds are go.
In American Gods, the culture hero Whiskey Jack spends most of his time hanging out with the American folk hero Johnny Appleseed.
The Lord is good to me, and so I thank the Lord for giving me the things I need, the sun and rain and an apple seed.
Folk tales regarding Mr. Appleseed are based on the real-life historical figure John Chapman, a Massachusetts-born nurseryman responsible for introducing apple tree nurseries to many American and some Canadian regions. He was also a preacher and missionary who was reputedly respected by many Native Americans who regarded him as touched by the Great Spirit. In folklore, he is said to have walked across America barefoot, wearing a cooking pot on his head and carrying a bag of appleseed, which he used to plant apple trees wherever he went. But that's a bit inflated. While the man died in 1845, his legend lived on, which is apparently why he's still alive in American Gods. Either that, or he's some kind of apple tree planting vampire.
This little man, he throwed his shadow clear across the land.
At some point in the novel, and I won't reveal when or where, Shadow meets a mysterious and very creepy creature from Germanic folklore called a kobold. The kobold are sprites who dwell in houses, castles, mines, and sometimes ships. They are usually invisible, but can appear as an animal, fire, a candle, or a childlike creature. A kobold is said to be benevolent if appeased, bringing luck and wealth to its hosts. But if unappeased, it can also be malicious. Kobolds are similar to the English hobgoblin or Scottish brownie, and like the fairy lore of other countries, they may have originated as pagan deities, but were adapted into folklore when Christianity arrived. In some sources, kobolds are thought to be the spirits of murdered children, and can sometimes appear to their hosts as such. I told you it was creepy, remember? Finally, we arrive at an entirely forgettable character from the novel. Shadow chauffeurs him on one occasion, and yet can't seem to remember him. Wednesday refers to the character several times, and yet Shadow can never quite recall his name. In fact, no one other than Wednesday ever seems to remember him. The novel never reveals who the man in the charcoal suit is, and Neil Gaiman hasn't spilled the beans either. So this is my interpretation of the character's identity, although it's a fairly common one among fans of the novel. If you don't even want to hear a theory regarding the identity of this character, please click away now. The man in the charcoal suit resides in Las Vegas, and has the ability to monitor and manipulate the constant flow of money through the city. This would be in keeping with the Roman god Mercury, who is a patron god of financial gain, commerce, and communication, among other things. His counterpart in Greek mythology is Hermes, and in Hindu mythology is Buddha, not to be confused with the founder of Buddhism, the Buddha. The man in the charcoal suit may be one of or an amalgamation of all three of these deities, as they all share similar aspects. All three are associated with knowledge, and by extension, memory. If the man in the charcoal suit can grant knowledge, it is likely he can also withdraw it, which would explain why no one other than Wednesday seems to remember him. The Romans associated Mercury with the Germanic god Wotan, aka Wednesday. Similarly, the Hindu god Buddha is the root of the Hindi word for Wednesday, Budvar. So perhaps the man in the charcoal suit is a version of Wednesday, or a close relative.
I have as many names as there are winds, as many titles as there are ways to die.
Well, those are all the gods and mythological beings prominently featured in the novel American Gods. However, there are many others that make brief appearances. A few have what I will refer to as minor speaking roles, like Ganesh, the Hindu god of new beginnings and success, and Gideon, a trickster figure from Welsh mythology. But the novel features a lot of extras and background players. I don't consider it much of a spoiler to reveal that at some point there will be a battle. And during this battle, many gods and mythical creatures will participate. Dozens are described in the novel, including a number of East Asian, African, European, South and Central American deities. But there are potentially hundreds more. So if you're upset that the series hasn't featured your favorite deities or mythology yet, my advice is to wait for the battle, because all kinds of characters from all kinds of mythology might show up. As for the new gods, I could cover them, but because they aren't based on any pre-existing mythology, your interpretation is as good as mine. But I'd love to hear what you think the new gods represent in the comments below. I hope you enjoyed my second video revealing the mythology behind American Gods. Please like the vid and subscribe to see more videos about mythology and pop culture, including another one covering the American Gods series if they introduce godly characters I didn't cover in this video. While Neil Gaiman has written several novels within the American Gods universe, he recently announced that he is writing a direct sequel to the original novel. So in time, there will be plenty more to cover.
And the most brilliant part is, I don't even know how to read!
Until next time, maybe on Budvar.